thank you, everybody. One more round of applause for the med section, guys. That was fantastic. I, too, want to thank Elizabeth from the Philly section and Steve from the med section and all the executive directors for all their hard work as well putting this together. So thank you, guys. The New Jersey section will be presenting on developing the coaching business, junior golf programming, and developing and branding yourself on social media. We have our director of instruction, Bill Schmedes, here from the home facility at Fiddler's Elbow. Take it away.
Guys, thank you very much for everyone coming in today. This is a true honor to be able to present in front of my peers. Great job by the Met section. I loved all those presentations. A lot of really good information there. Today, you're in store to hear all the secrets. I have every single secret there is out there. I'm just kidding, obviously. As we know in our business, there is not too many secrets. But what I do have is experience in building three separate coaching businesses in three different regions of the country at both the public and private facilities. So I believe no matter what your title is today, because I know we all have different roles at the club, we should be able to take something from this presentation, bring it back to your club, and potentially implement it. So I'm going to walk around a little bit today and see how many necks I can tweet. So let's see if we got this working here. Okay, fantastic. So before we get going, I'll just give you a little bit of background about myself. I've worked and studied under multiple top 50 and top 100 coaches in the country, including Gary Gilchrist and Patty McGowan. I've been coaching professionally for just over 12 years now. I've assisted 16 tour players on the PGA, LPGA, European Tour, and Web.com tours. I worked with Yanni Tsang, she was number one in the world. Shan-Chan Fong and Charles Howlett are probably the most notable. Coached a junior to the number one ranking in his home country of Peru. Been awarded by Golf Digest as the best young teacher in America. And I have also authored my own book titled 5 Core Fundamentals of Golf, which can be found on Amazon.com. Alright, so now that I've made myself feel really good about myself, we'll get into this. Today I'm going to discuss 5 keys that I think have allowed me to be very successful in different areas of the country and at different type clubs. I'm going to try and give myself about 5 minutes for questions and some answers at the end, but we'll get right into it here. That's my wife's number. E1. Setting yourself apart from the competition. I think this is really important for all of us, no matter the title that we have at the club, whether you're an assistant golf professional, director of instruction, or an independent contractor. So I always like to learn from the best. So if we think about a couple of these names, I want you to tell me the first thing that pops in your mind, so we'll get a little participation from you guys right now. When you think of Jim McClain, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? You can just shout him out. Fantastic. So he's branded himself at Doral. I would think Full Swinger Golf School. What about James Seton? Short game, right? For sure. It's awesome. David Rose? Fitness, TPI, right? And finally, most of you should know this, Henry Brunt. There you go, Canada, absolutely. He runs an incredible junior golf program or golf academy out in Canada. So they are all well known for the niche that they have developed. I think all of us as professionals need to do the same exact thing. So we need to think about what makes you different and who are you? What makes you different from the person down the road or even from one of the other professionals at your club? How are you going to get people in? So my niche personally is long-term development for serious golfers. And I do that with both juniors and adults. That's all I've ever done. We'll talk about the programs that I do run in a few minutes, but I keep it very simple. very basic. Originally, I started with these programs at the club level. I've then gone on and produced these at the regional, and now getting some recognition at the national level, which is fantastic. So we'll move on here. I love this picture. This reminds me of when I was down south. All right, so you got a guy hanging out on the side of the road, fishing pole, and a beer. This leads us to key number two. So anybody here enjoy fishing? Probably a couple of us, right? I know I like fishing, especially when there's beer involved. How well are we going to do if we go out fishing? We either have the wrong bait, wrong lures, or no bait at all. Probably not going to do very well. So your coaching business is really no different, and that gets us into this, branding. So branding is really big to me, whether it's the club level, the regional level, or the national level. When you think about some of the biggest names in our industry, David Ledbetter, Jim McClain, Butch Harmon, sure, they're world-class coaches now, but they all started being really good marketing themselves and branding themselves in what they do. So I think we can all do a better job of this as golf professionals. First thing, I've got four things that I'll talk about here. I like four things, keep it as simple as I can. I think a website, having a website presence is really important. It doesn't need to be anything extravagant, but you need a landing page. So we all live in a world where if somebody wants to know about you, you Google them. I do it all the time. Typically, I just Google myself, but but if I want to know something about anyone, I go online and on Google. And if you have a website, there's credibility. The person that is looking for information can see who you are, the programs you run, what you've done in your career, so you need a landing page. I think that's really important. Just make sure when you do have a website that it's pretty easy to navigate. The one thing that that I've been told is if the website is difficult to navigate and the person can't find what they're looking for in a couple seconds, they will go elsewhere. So you should have a couple easy tabs that actually take you to the information they're looking for. This is probably more for just professionals that are almost teaching full time, but SEO or search engine optimization is really important. If you want to be the guy in New Jersey for junior golf, you need to make sure that your website is tagged such that when people Google junior golf here in New Jersey, you're one of the first names that come up. So search engine optimization is really good. It's a little bit expensive, but it's well worth it if you want to be one of the first people that that come up on a search. Social media presence, I think, is really important. You can do it very simple, or you can go all out. So for me personally, I am on all social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, LinkedIn. I really don't use LinkedIn all that much for more than just connecting with my peers. And then YouTube. Now, you don't need to be on all those, but I think you should be on a few. So what I do for my older clientele, most of that goes on Facebook. So my older clientele will get content, information on Facebook. My younger clientele, which is my juniors, it's pretty much all on Instagram, Snapchat, a little bit on Twitter. But typically I just use Instagram and Snapchat. The kids love it and the parents love it as well. So anytime my kids do well in a tournament, we're posting it right on Snapchat. It gives you credibility as a golf coach that you care and you're invested in your player. LinkedIn, again, just a great way to network. Don't use that too much. YouTube, I don't use YouTube as much as I used to, but if you are a, if you're trying to make a name for yourself in this industry or you run golf schools, I think YouTube is a great way to get content out there for a mass audience to see. So there's been a couple gentlemen that come off the top of my head that have done a great job with YouTube. Jeff Ritter, Andrew Rice, and Mark Chuck have pretty much almost made their careers beginning on YouTube. And they're always putting content out there, and they do very well. Email marketing. Email marketing, probably not what it sounds like to me. Anytime I have a new player that comes in, I make sure that I'm getting all their information from email address, phone number, and address. And they go into a database so that anytime I'm putting out information or I'm sending out videos or any other content, they're on that email chain. And whether they're going to use your services or they're going to look at your information, they're probably going to either let some of their friends or family know or send it to some of their friends or family. So you're gonna, it's gonna work out well for you. It's definitely worked out well for me, as pretty much all my business is off word of mouth. Finally, content. Content can be in a couple different forms. If you're just at the club level, you can create weekly or monthly blogs to your membership or to certain groups. If you're trying to make a name for yourself, you can start maybe putting blogs out to mass audiences or writing for publications. I write for Golf Works. I've been in magazines like Golf Tips Magazine and Golf Digest, and Golf Digest Online and Golf Tips Magazine. Probably already said that. Just various other publications. Anything to get your name out there so when someone searches you, they're going to come up with a long list of what you do as a golf professional or as a golf coach. Move on to key three now. Building your culture. So we've identified, hopefully, a niche now. Now our programming should match that. So if you're James Siegman, and as you guys told me, James Siegman is obviously well known for short game. If you go see James Siegman and he does just 2 days of full swing golf schools, that probably doesn't match up with what he's known for, right? So our businesses should pretty much be no different. Doesn't mean we can't coach other things, but for the most part, your programming needs to match the niche. So I have called like an In-N-Out Burger model. For those of you that aren't aware, In-N-Out Burger is a fast food chain out west. They have like, I think only three or four options. They got like a cheeseburger, a double cheeseburger, a bacon cheeseburger. That's about it. All stuff I like, by the way. So they keep it very simple for their consumer. I think we need to do the same thing. I see so many other golf coaches, they've got just lists and lists and lists of programs. So if we can simplify what we do, I think it's not only it's easier on you, it's also gonna be, you know, easier on your student when it comes down to deciding what's best for them. So drawing people in, how do we get people in once you've got your programming, you figured out your niche? That's really important. Now, before I get to that, let me just jump back to programming for one sec. This In-N-Out Burger model. I offer pretty much three programs, is all I do. I have individual coaching programs that all begin with an evaluation, and then based on the player's goals and what we see in the evaluation, I will offer one of three programs. I have a 10-hour package, a 20-hour, or a season long. I then offer one group program for adults and only one group program for juniors. So that's it. So I've got my individual coaching, just one big program. I've got my group adult and my group junior. That's it. So Carl's or Carl's junior. In-N-Out Burger model. Getting hungry here. Okay, so now we need to get people in. So how do we do that? So I'll just talk about when I first got to Fiddler's real quick. Because it's the most recent position, it's my third season here now. Came up from Orlando, Florida, and I knew absolutely nobody here in New Jersey or at this golf club. So I need to figure out, okay, how do I get people in when they know nothing about me? So obviously this is a really big club, you've all seen that today. I had to go all over this club and meet and greet every single player and staff member. I think staff can be just as important as meeting all your members, because they are typically the first touch that that member will see. So you might see somebody once a week, the staff member sees them six times a week. So if you give the staff member some type of an incentive, that maybe you throw them a free lesson every once in a while, if he sends you a couple extra golfers, that's another way to get them in. So I had to meet and greet everyone around here. I had to build relationships, because I think in our business, relationships are key. The technology's great, you have to be a halfway decent teacher, but if you can't create personal relationships, really doesn't matter. So once you get these people in, which is, I think, at times can be the most difficult part early on. Then you need to showcase your ability. So what does that mean? So for me, when I first started here, I began with some feeder programs like clinics and golf schools and junior camps just to get people in to see what I do as a golf coach and who I am as a person. And then from there, I got most of those players to actually go into my coaching programs that I wanted in my first year here. So if you can get someone in, show them what you're about as a golf coach, you can get them a little bit better, and show them that you're a great guy and you actually care about them and their goals and their potential progress, that's huge. And then word of mouth spreads. That's third season here, and I'm batting people away with sticks. So word of mouth spreads. Don't need to do any advertising. That's really important. So real quickly, I'm just going to go over a couple figures here. You guys can change these figures. You can change the programs and tweak them, but I just want to give you some ideas. So 2015 was my first season. Again, I offered, as I mentioned, a couple adult clinics and schools and junior golf camps. Those clinics and schools all happened pretty much in the first month just to get people in. I then funneled them into my individual coaching programs. So I had those three options after the evaluation. I would either offer a 10-hour, which I charged $1,500, a 20-hour, which was $2,700, or a season-long, which was $4,000. So if somebody comes in, they've got grand goals, they're a 30 handicap, they want to get down somehow to a 20 at the end of the year. One, you can be honest with them and say, that's quite a feat, but I think we can do it based on doing X, Y, Z, based on what we saw today. And people appreciate that. So then you say, okay, this is the program for you. I build the plan out for them. This is how we're going to train. This is how you're going to practice. And then I book everybody out. So I say, you're my Wednesday, 1 o'clock, you're gonna run through this program, and then we're either gonna re-up you or someone else comes in. So after season one, doing that, average just over about 15,000 a month. 2016, brought in another coach because I'm way too busy. Continue to offer three individual coaching programs, which I kept at the same pricing. I added a group junior program, which we call the Junior Elite. We train pretty much weekly, two-hour sessions, totaling eight hours of instructional time per month, and that was over a nine-month period. So they had to commit to 9 months. That was $399 a month. I added a group adult program. We called it the Biggest Loser. There's some other guys that have done a very similar program. I had five guys that wanted to just practice and train together. And that was pretty much the pilot to figure out how I could make this more successful. And they loved it. They all got better. Our winner dropped his handicap by 6 strokes. That was weekly training, 90-minute sessions, and I charged $275 a month. So after season two, was averaging just over $19,000 a month, which is about $4,000 increase. And I worked one less day. Instead of seven, that was six. And then 2017, which is this year, switching things up just a little bit, keeping my individual programs, increased pricing a little bit on the 10-hour and the 20, so the 10-hour went from $1,500 to $1,700, 20-hour went from $2,700 to $3,000, I kept the season as is. I brought back the Junior Elite program, but the price went up from $399 to $475, and I increased my Biggest Loser program. This is what I'm most happy about, because this program is fun. I increased the Biggest Loser program from those original five guys, and now we've got 36 players. Instead of training every single week, it is bi-weekly. So the price went down a little bit, $225, but a lot of players at $225, and it's a great program that people love. And you can run those programs however you want, you can make whatever figures you want, but it's a great way to coach your players up and not have to work nearly as much. So this year, I'm only going to be working 5 days a week instead of seven originally, and then it was six. And I'll be making over just about $22,000 a month based on those numbers. And again, you can change that any way that you would like. Numbers, programs, but it's capable. Everyone says that it's difficult in golf instruction to make money. I don't think it is. I don't care what club you're at. If you're good with people and you're halfway decent at coaching, you're going to be able to be very successful. Managing your empire. So you're doing great, but now what? I think maintaining is key. Statistics will show us that. So if you're trying to bring in new clients, It's obviously way more difficult and more expensive to try and bring in new clients opposed to trying to maintain and build on the ones that you currently have. So how do you maintain those clients? For me, and again, you'll hear me saying this a lot over the next couple minutes here, you gotta be great with people. You gotta provide what I call the lifetime effect. So that's frequent contact and reaching out at all times to current and former players. Whether it's a text, seeing them at the club and talking with them for 2 minutes, giving them a call every once in a while, going out to dinner with them, having a drink with them, whatever it might be. People love that stuff. Because again, it shows that you're invested and you care about them, their golf games, and you're all about taking them to the next level, whether they're currently working with you or they're just taking a little time off. So you can have the pick of your litter or the pick of the litter if you're good with people, which is great because once you get busy, we've all got some players that we really don't like working with, but they keep coming, and you're like, oh man, it's 3 o'clock, we got this half can. But once you get really busy, you can start to, maybe if you're at a member of a club, you can't, but at a lot of places, you can start to pick and choose who you want because you're already very busy. So never lose sight that we work in a people business. Technology is awesome. I love it. We've got a bunch of technology here. I use it every day. But if you want to make more money, you got to be great with people. Follow success with success. So I've got this Live 369 thing going on. It almost sounds like I've got a boy band or something. Live 369. But what I try and do as a golf coach is I'm constantly thinking out in the future. So for me, I'm a golf coach, but I'm more of a businessman in a sense, where if you go in my office, I've got 4 whiteboards all around, and I've got ideas, and I'm thinking every single night on how I can do a better job as a golf coach, how I can change my programs to be more efficient, both with my time, to provide a better product maybe, and then also make more money and not work nearly as much. We've all got families here, and being at the club 7 days a week is not great for families, as many of us know. Can't be afraid of change. I've got a lot of friends that they're pretty successful. They do the same thing every single year over and over and over again, and they keep making the same money. It's good money. But after a while, that gets boring doing, and you're never going to reach your potential. Last one there, spend time with doers. I like this one a lot. So I'm always trying to travel around and go to seminars or reaching out to some folks that I know that do a great job in our industry as golf coaches. Spend time with those people. Figure out who in this section is constantly coaching. Who am I constantly hearing about? Go spend time with them. Don't spend time trying to book a flight to go see somebody that's on Facebook forums all day long bantering about how my technology is the best and you're wrong and this data isn't correct and how dare they say this when this is right. If they're that successful, how can you be on Facebook all the time? I never get it. All right, a couple more opinions from me. That is me and G Money there with Chan Chan Fung. Couple years ago, she was like 5 in the world then. Right here. Okay, so we've got the Stack and Tilt boys on the top left. We've got Jimmy Ballard and Rocket Mediate on the top right. David Ledbetter doing the A-swing thing on the bottom left, and Hank Haney on the bottom right. So all these guys, they've all got their methods or theories. They're all right. They're all right for someone. Right? So I think spending time shadowing with people that do a bunch of different things is super important. It's not about who's right. Everyone's right. Doesn't mean they're all right for every single golfer. But all we do in our industry is complain about the best way to do it. There isn't a best way. There's only a best way for the person in front of you. So shadow others you might disagree with, and you'll pick up a bunch of stuff. So just remember this, what you teach, how you teach it, and your knowledge really doesn't mean anything to your players if you can't get buy-in. If, let's say they're even getting better. You've got players that are coming in, they're getting better, but they don't enjoy their time. They're not going to want to continue to spend money. I get a lot of people over the years that have spent time with predominant big-name coaches, and they said, it wasn't that he didn't help me get better. I learned a lot, but I didn't enjoy my time at all. Wasn't comfortable there. So again, getting back to that personal effect. So if you want to be a little more successful, technology, all that stuff's great. I love it. But I think we need to put more effort into how people learn, how to build relationships, and I think even how to sell things, right? I mean, that's kind of what we do. We help people with their golf games. It should sell itself, but being a little more knowledgeable on how to kind of sell yourself and sell maybe some of your programs can't hurt. So I'm always interested in those things. And then finally here, just a couple additional values that I think as golf coaches we can give our players. So obvious stuff, technology. If you've got technology, don't be afraid to promote it. It's expensive things, people like it. Like for TrackMan, we rent TrackMan out, there are bays out, people can use the combines. People love that stuff. Sam Putt Lab, we've got pressure mats here. Don't be afraid to sell yourself with technology. Practice privileges. This is something that's interesting to me. I haven't done it here yet, but I do know some guys that are doing it. So part of your programming, if you can add in practice privileges, whether it's same day of, before or after your lesson, or in between lessons, I think that's another great additional value. Just build it into your programs, and you can make a little bit more money, or the club can make a little bit more money. Chatted about this for a couple slides back. Text and follow-ups. Again, the personal touch. My phone is always buzzing, but I don't mind sending a text or giving a phone call back. It takes 30 seconds of your day, and it goes a long way into having that person for life. And then finally, I love this, online training space. I found Edgify when they first came out a couple years ago. I love Edgify. I don't know if you guys are aware, but it's kind of like V1, but for me, everything from every single program or every single session I run with somebody goes into the player's personal Edgify account. So they know how to practice. They know what we're working on. There's no confusion. There's a reply button. They can send me a message if they want about what, you know, how to set the drill up or whatever it might be in the video that I attach. And again, it's just an additional thing that adds a lot of value to you as a golf coach. Because again, you're taking that extra step to go and care about your player. All right, so Tommy, how are we doing on time? Do we have a couple minutes for questions?
You've got 3 minutes for questions.
I got 3 minutes, he says. All right, I'll start counting. Any questions?
Bill, can you talk a little bit about renting out the technology, what you charge, what access you give your members to? Obviously, the technology is complicated. Yeah. Do you give your members full access to it?
That's a great question. So, holy speaker, sorry. We rent out bays in, is it half hour increments, Maddie?
1 hour, 45 minutes.
You can see how much I do.
1 hour, 45 minutes, 55 minutes.
There you go, so 1 hour. And that's pretty comparable with the other indoor facilities here. A little more expensive, it's 45 on the weekend?
45 weekend, 55 weekend.
Got it, 55 on the weekend, 45 on the weekday. 1 hour, and that is just for the bay up to, we only allow 2 players in our bay at a time. But we do have at least 2 bays that we can rent out. We also developed a TrackMan Combine League, which was great. People like that a lot, constantly seeing their strengths and their weaknesses. What do we charge for that, Matt?
It was $500 for the season.
$500 for the season, so that's no-brainer. Put me out of business here, Matt.
Ladies League,
Junior League. We do a lot of things.
What about educating?
Yeah. So here's the thing we haven't quite got into, and this is like, I don't know if we'd even want to do it, because one, that technology costs a lot of money. So you wouldn't want, at least I wouldn't want, it's my technology, I wouldn't want people in there unsupervised. even after you educate them on how to set it up or how to use it. So like we have, throughout the winter, we had somebody in there pretty much at all times that would set the player up for their session with TrackMan, right? Whether it's simulator use or a TrackMan combine or, you know, you name it. Same thing with the junior programs and the women's programs. There's always somebody, a buddy in there. So you need a body in there. That's the only issue. Yes? Yes, so they would be alternating. So our deal in the winter is our big bay doors close. We have a net that wraps around. We've got a projector up here. So it's pretty much your simulator golf. TrackMan's reading it behind, showing you the ball flight on the screen, whether you're playing golf or you're just using TrackMan for a combine or just working on your game. But they have to alternate. Yeah.
30 minutes. You do
30-minute
sessions.
Do I?
No, you do.
On your website, is 30-minute lesson? Is
that yeah, so that's for that's pretty much for my juniors. Okay. And some of the information, I talk about having a great website, some of my information on the website is a little bit outdated there. I do run that with a couple of my juniors. So with the, I've got a couple of juniors in that where we start off with an evaluation, and then following the evaluation, they will get 30-minute sessions from there. It was like this broad scheme I had. I'm like, I'm going to fit more people in 30 minutes, and I was like, nah.
Is your lesson typically an hour?
Correct. Now, with those individual coaching programs, the hours can technically be used any way that they would like, but I try and make sure that most players are an hour each session. And like I said, I book everybody out immediately. So if they're doing 20 hours, I say, great, Tuesdays at 2 through this date to that date, that's what we're doing. If that doesn't work, I throw a bunch of dates, we figure it all out. Maybe it's a Tuesday, 1 week, Friday, next week. So that's pretty much what we do. I'll have to update my website, thanks. Yeah.
Bill, I have those training programs. Which one is most popular?
Yeah, so the thing that I'm trying to do, I'm trying to get like group instruction to be like fun and for people to actually want to do it. But right now, the individual stuff is king. Everyone wants individual sessions. So out of the individual, it used to be 10 hours. Now the 20 hour is actually more popular than the 10 hour. For the individual. Now I'm trying to do more group stuff so I don't need to be here as much and I can still make a decent amount that way. And I've just started this probably last year and now it's the Biggest Loser is getting pretty big. So I'm going to try and see if we can maintain that or even build the Biggest Loser and then try and branch that off to like my junior programs and everything else. Because I think group's where it's at. I mean, if you can still teach. I think you can still give your players just as much doing group. But I think it's just education. And once the players get in, I got those five guys, once they get in and they witness you and your coaching and how you work with everyone in the group, and I work with everyone in a group but individually, so I'll have like a whiteboard and I'll have like a plan out every single time. Say, okay, Tommy, you're doing this, and Bobby, you're doing this, and this is how I want you to practice the first 10 minutes doing this, and then the following 10 doing this. So they have a plan for each session. Yep. Anyone else? Fantastic. I went over 3 minutes, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I lied. It was a good 5 minutes.